the presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Come bow before Him now with reverence and fear. Of the Lord, the Holy One is here.
Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. He
everyone, and welcome to our online service of worship for today, Sunday the 6th of June. Today we're looking at our reading from the Gospel of Mark, where Jesus is being rather overwhelmed by all of the crowds. The religious leaders accuse him of being possessed by an evil spirit, and even his family believe that he is out of his mind. But as we might expect, Jesus responds in a way that quietens them all. Our call to worship. Come, everyone, just as you are, to worship the Lord. Whether today we feel strong or weak, full or empty, God welcomes us into the family of faith. Come, everyone, just as you are, come to worship the Lord. Let's pray together. Loving Lord, you look us in the eye and you remind us that we are already part of your family. Help us to let go of anything that gets in the way of our time with you today, so that we may worship you with all our hearts and wholeheartedly love our neighbours as ourselves. God of all, as one family, we worship you. We are mothers and fathers, we are sisters and brothers, and we worship you. We are sons and daughters, aunts and uncles, grannies and granddads, and we worship you. We are cousins and neighbours, friends and colleagues, and we worship you. As your family, as your church, as your community, we worship you. Amen. Jesus draws crowds of followers in Galilee, where his family are concerned about the fear and the rumours that surround him. Mark uses a story within a story to increase the ever-present drama. Both stories speak of relationships and how we behave towards one another. Jesus redefines family as those who follow the will of God, and he therefore redraws the boundaries for community. This week, we tune in to the subtle or loud voices that undermine the well-being of community. And we listen for the equally subtle or insistent voice that patiently restores us as individuals to community, to being part of God's in-crowd. It is hard to be fully aware of what is influencing us, and we need many diverse and honest voices to help us to see ourselves as we really are. Our points for today are going to be: stick to the plan, regardless of pressure; Jesus understands and guides; and walking in forgiveness. But before we do anything else, we affirm that we have come to worship today, for God is love. We sing together: God is love, His the care.
God is love, His the care, tending each everywhere. God is love, all is there. Jesus came to show Him, that mankind might know Him. Sing aloud, sing aloud. God is good, God is truth, God is beauty, praise Him. Jesus lived here for men, strove and died, rose again, rules our hearts now as then, for He came to save.
Our psalm for today is Psalm 130.
Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can, with reverence, serve you. I wait for the Lord, my whole being waits, and in His word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord, more than watchmen wait for the morning, more than watchmen wait for the morning. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with Him is full redemption. He Himself will redeem Israel from all their sins.
As we reflect on the psalm we've just heard, we focus particularly on verse 3, where we read, "If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand?" We sing together, "Only by grace can we enter." Now to our prayers of adoration and confession. Let's pray together. Loving God, in Jesus and through the power of the Holy Spirit, you show us that there is always room at your table for one more. All praise and honour be unto you. There is always enough time for everyone to be listened to. All praise and honour be unto you. There is always enough respect for everyone to be valued. All praise and honour be unto you. There is always enough truth for everyone to grow and to learn. All praise and honour be unto you. There is always a second chance for those who once were turned away. All praise and honour be unto you. For the crowd that we long to be part of, the in-crowd of your never-ending love, is always growing and always welcoming. All praise and honour be unto you. But, Lord Jesus, when our in-crowd is not your crowd, forgive us and help us to build community. When our words are harsh and our actions are unkind, forgive us and help us to build community. When we judge others rather than joining with others, forgive us and help us to build community. When we are set in our ways and not open to change, forgive us and help us to build community. And we thank you that your forgiveness is real and offered to all who truly repent. God of truth and of mercy, where we break down, you build up. Where we damage, you repair. When we blaspheme, you bless. Where we isolate, you include. Where we go wrong, you put us right. Where we confess, you forgive. And where we begin again, you are with us. We offer ourselves to you in Jesus' name. Amen. We thank God now for the forgiveness that is ours through the blood of Christ as we sing together, All My Hope on God is Founded.
Thank you.
come now to our reading from the Gospel of Mark.
Mark chapter 3. Then Jesus entered a house, and again a crowd gathered, so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. When his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, "He's out of his mind." And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, "He is possessed by Beelzebul. By the prince of demons, he's driving out demons." So Jesus called them over to him and began to speak to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house without first tying him up. Then he can plunder the strong man's house. Truly I tell you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander they utter, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They are guilty of an eternal sin. He said this because they were saying, "He has an impure spirit." Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived. Standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting round him, and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my mother and my brothers?" he asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother."
As we allow that reading to be absorbed into our hearts and minds, we focus particularly on the final words of the reading. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother. We sing together as the deer pants for the water. At the beginning of our gospel reading for today, we're told that the crowd that were gathered prevented both Jesus and his disciples from getting anything to eat. And for this very reason, Jesus' friends and family came in order to, as it is put, take charge of him. They did this as they were concerned that Jesus had perhaps gone over the top as some sort of religious fanatic. But although it's understandable to an extent that they were concerned for his well-being, they totally missed the point of his entire ministry. Even those who were closest to Jesus were rather slow to understand who he was and what he had come to do. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law could not deny the reality of Jesus and the reality of the miracles he performed through some sort of supernatural power that they did not understand. However, they refused to believe that his power came from God, as they would then have to accept him as the Messiah. Ultimately, their pride would not allow them to do that. So, in an attempt to destroy Jesus' popularity among the people, the teachers of the law accused him of having power from Satan rather than from God. But Jesus' reply showed that their argument made absolutely no sense whatsoever. It's true that God permits Satan to work in our world, but the bottom line is that God is still very much in control. Because Jesus was and is the second person of the Holy Trinity, he was and is fully God. And as such, he therefore has power over Satan. Jesus is able to drive out demons and to end their terrible work in people's lives. And ultimately, as we read in Revelation 20, Satan will be bound forever. The words from verses 28 and 29 can be a little confusing when it comes to those who blaspheme against the Holy Spirit, never being forgiven and being guilty of an eternal sin. Some Christians worry if they have ever perhaps committed the sin of blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, but we don't have to worry. What is meant here is that the work of the Holy Spirit is being attributed to the devil. It reveals a heart attitude of unbelief and a total refusal to repent. Deliberate, ongoing rejection of the work of the Holy Spirit is blasphemy, because it's rejecting God himself. The religious leaders accused Jesus of blasphemy, but perhaps rather ironically, they were the ones who were guilty when they looked Jesus in the face and accused him of being possessed by the devil. The final part of the reading for today is also a little bit confusing. When Jesus asked the question and says, "Who are my mother and brothers?" We know, of course, that Mary was the mother of Jesus. And it's likely that the brothers that were mentioned were the children that Mary and Joseph had after Jesus. However, some Christian traditions believe that Jesus was Mary's only child. But if this is true, not that I'm saying that it is, then brothers would probably refer to cousins, as cousins were often called brothers in those days. Some have offered yet another suggestion. Again, not that I'm saying that it's true, but some traditions believe that when Joseph married Mary, he was a widower, and these were children by his first marriage. That's possibly a little bit of a curved ball, and I don't want to get too distracted by it, but perhaps it's something to delve deeper into on another occasion. Whatever the situation, it's clear from what we read that Jesus' family did not yet fully understand his ministry, but Jesus explains that in our spiritual family, the relationships are ultimately more important and longer lasting than those formed in our physical families. God's true family should be accepting and should not exclude anyone. Although Jesus cared for his mother and his brothers, he also cared for those who loved him and those who followed him. Jesus did not show partiality. He allowed everyone the privilege of obeying God and becoming part of his family. And in our increasingly impersonal world today, Warm relationships among members of God's family are increasingly important. Our churches can give the loving and personalised care that many people are unable to find anywhere else. So let's look at our points for today. Firstly, stick to the plan regardless of pressure. Secondly, Jesus understands and guides. And finally, walking in forgiveness. Our first point, stick to the plan regardless of pressure, is taken from verse 21 of our reading, where we're told that Jesus' family thought he was out of his mind. And let's face it, when any of us face opposition, the easiest option is to go with the crowd. But we need to follow the example of Jesus and stick to the plan, stick to what we know in our hearts God is expecting of us. When we look at Mark 6, we're reminded of Jesus' words when he said, "A prophet is honoured everywhere except in his own hometown." In other places, Jesus was considered to be a hero, but there was always a broad spectrum of reaction to who and what Jesus was. And we are not beyond that either. So how did Jesus handle his family? Well, it's worth noting that he didn't try to control their behaviour, nor did he let their behaviour control his. He loved them, but he didn't demand that they always agreed with him. He didn't sulk or retaliate when they insulted him. And he didn't make it his mission in life to try and please them. If our family is making it difficult for us to serve the Lord, we need to observe a few things about Jesus. Firstly, he recognized that his spiritual family could provide what his physical family didn't. That's why we all need the support and the stability that comes from fellowship in a local church. Next, he didn't let the difficult dynamic of family overshadow his call from God. Our family may not understand or agree, but we can't let that keep us from doing what God has called us to do. And finally, Jesus refused to let the opinion of the crowd dictate his direction. As we read in Luke chapter 4, the whole town of Capernaum tried to keep him from leaving them, but he said, "I must proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God to other towns also, because this is why I was sent." Just imagine the whole town wanting us to stay, and yet we leave anyway. Could all those people be wrong? Yes, Jesus followed the will of God, and we must do the same. Point one is sticking to the plan, regardless of pressure. The second thing that we're looking at is that Jesus understands and guides us. This is taken mainly from verse 30 of our reading, where the religious leaders were saying that Jesus had an impure spirit within him. But it also draws on some words from Hebrews 4. The fact is that the Lord understands what we are going through today and every day, because he has been where we are. The Bible tells us in Hebrews 4, "We do not have a high priest who is unable to feel sympathy for our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." This essentially means that Jesus understands our family problems because he had a family of his own. And on one occasion, as we've already mentioned, they said, "He is out of his mind." Jesus also understands that at certain times, all of us can feel totally overwhelmed. In Mark 6, Jesus says, "Let us go off by ourselves to a quiet place and rest." He said this because this was another occasion where there were so many people coming and going that Jesus and his apostles didn't even have time to eat. The thing that we have to remember is that Jesus not only dealt with on-the-job pressures, he had to organize, he had to train, and he had to correct his own followers, including a group of uneducated fishermen a bigot, and a despised tax collector. Jesus equally understands when we feel rejected. The town he grew up in had no use for him, as we read in John chapter 1. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Once again, later in John 1, we read, when Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael replied, "Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?" And Jesus' family tree was nothing to write home about either. Rahab was a prostitute, Jacob was a crook, and David was an adulterer, just to name a few. But we have to remember that Jesus understands. He knows where we're at today, and he's able to help us. All we have to do is to talk to him, and then to listen. Point two is that Jesus understands and guides us. The third and final thing that we're looking at today is walking in forgiveness. This is taken from the first part of verse 28, where we read, "Truly I tell you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander they utter." It also triggers in my mind the story of Joseph and his brothers from the book of Genesis. 17 years after being reunited with Joseph, his long-lost son, Jacob died, and Joseph's brothers panicked. They started to think, now Joseph will pay us back for the evil we did him. So they got together and made up a story and sent word to Joseph saying, "Before your father died, he instructed us to say to you, please forgive your brothers for the great wrong they did to you." Now, when we stop and think seriously about it, if their father really had said this, he wouldn't have told Joseph's brothers, he would have told Joseph himself, surely. He wouldn't have gone to his grave with the fear that Joseph might exact revenge. When Joseph heard that his brothers doubted his forgiveness, he called them together and wept, saying, "Don't be afraid, I myself will take care of you and your families." And we're told that he spoke very kindly to them and reassured them. True forgiveness, the kind that we find in Scripture, is a commitment that all of us must practice every day of our lives. Generally speaking, people need loving the most when they deserve it the least. But no one ever said that it would be easy. If Jesus had waited until his enemies repented, he would never have prayed on the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." Certainly, it's easier to forgive when others acknowledge their offence. But if that's the prerequisite, we may never experience victory. And what we don't forgive, we have to relive. So for our own sake, we need to forgive. We need to take back our life. We need to begin to walk in the blessing of the Lord. Point three is walking in forgiveness. As we continue to ponder both our reading for today and also the reflections that I have offered, let's remind ourselves of our points for today. Stick to the plan, regardless of pressure. Jesus understands and guides us, and walking in forgiveness. And may God's holy name be glorified in all things. Amen. As we continue to reflect, we sing together, "Who Would True Valor See?"
Thank you.
now to our prayers of intercession. Let's pray together. God of all the world, we praise you for calling us into your family, for choosing us even though we are imperfect, for trusting us even though we make mistakes, for not giving up on us when we give up on ourselves, for offering so much more even when we would settle for less. God of all the world, for drawing us into a deeper relationship with you and with one another, we praise you. Individually and together, we praise you. Loving and eternal God, our prayers for others challenge us and move us and bring us ever closer to your presence. We pray for those so overburdened with wealth and belongings that their lives are a constant worry. We pray for those so starved of food and deprived of comfort and even the basic amenities in their lives, that this is a constant worry. We pray for those near to us who need our prayers because of illness, death, neglect, or trauma. Eternal God, you hear our prayers. You know our yearnings and desires, and you know those for whom we pray. We commit them and ourselves, our living and our dying, into your hands. Mother and Father God, you invite all of us to be part of your family, unique members of your in crowd. Help us to let you deal with the pains that cause destructive behavior and destroy communities. Nurture in us your healing that releases in us qualities of love and makes your community attractive, healing, open, and welcome to all. And we bring all of our prayers together as we say the words of the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As I was thinking about a hymn to bring our service of worship and praise to a close today, there were two that kept going through my mind. So rather than choosing between them, we're going to have both. We sing together, For I'm building a people of power, and then you shall go out with joy.
People of power, and I'm making a people of prayer. strong, Lord. Join our hearts, Lord, through your Son. Make us one, Lord, in your body, in the kingdom of your Son.
Loving God, you sent your Son into your world to gather us all up into your kingdom. Be with us as we hear and as we respond to your call to do the same. And as we go, may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us, with all those we love and with all those we have and continue to pray for, both this day and forevermore. Amen.
Church, Lord, make us strong, Lord. Join our hearts, Lord, through your Son. Make us one, Lord.